I love his love for this church and love for his pastor. And I believe the word of God, the word of God that's going to come to this man's mouth this morning is exactly what's been released at the throne. Amen. So I invite you to fasten your seatbelts and get ready to receive our own brother, Minister Eddie Howard.
Hallelujah. Every praise is to our God. Every praise is to our God. Sometimes we praise home, but every praise should be to our God. Sometimes we praise vehicles, but every praise, come on now, should be to our God. Every now and again, we'll praise the bank account, but every praise should be to our God. Y'all know I'm telling the truth up here. Every praise to our God. Every praise to our God. Seek you first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all them things we sometime praise will be added to you. I know the scripture ain't said just like that, but y'all know I'm right. Y'all know I'm right. We will praise things louder in the air first Sunday than we will praise God. Now let's give God a hand clap up in here. That's what I'm talking about. That's what I'm talking about. Give God some praises up in here, church, because every praise should be to our God. Every praise. Father, we thank you this morning. We thank you, God. We honor you this morning. God, we give you the glory this morning. God, we welcome your manifest spirit in here this morning, God. God, we ask you to speak to our hearts this morning, God. God, open our minds up, God, that we may hear what you are saying to the church this morning, God. And God, that we can continue to give you the praise. We can continue to give you the honor. We can continue to give you the glory this morning, God. God, we just coming for you. Holy Spirit. You. We welcome you not just in this place. We welcome you in our hearts, Holy Spirit. We welcome you in our head, Holy Spirit. We welcome you in our body, Holy Spirit. We just welcome you, Holy Spirit. We ask you to take your rightful place right here. Move them things out, Holy Spirit, that don't belong in here. We ask you from the crown of our head, Holy Spirit, to the sole of our feet, Holy Spirit, that you just come in and dwell with us. Just become our intimate part of us, Holy Spirit. Have your way today. Ah, Father God, we love you today. Have your way today, Holy Spirit. Jesus the Christ, we love you today. Have your way, Holy Spirit. Have your way, Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. Have your way, Holy Spirit. 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 Dwell in this house today. Dwell in this vessel today. Let us speak to me, Holy Spirit. Speak through me, Holy Spirit. Have your way, that ears may hear, oh Lord God, hearts may understand. minds be changed, that they can, people can say, Lord, what you want for me today, God? In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Y'all can be seated. Hallelujah. Thank you, God. Y'all can be seated. Y'all can be seated. You know, as I try to prepare this sermon, you know, I could hear all the pastor's sermon just rushing back to me. You know. And you know, the one that kind of stood out the most is when he, last Sunday, he talked about Judas Iscariot was a disciple of Jesus. And even though Jesus knew what was going to happen, he still said, Judas, come follow me. I want to make you a disciple also. Even though he knew that Judas' task was not going to be like the rest of them task. See, church, every now and then we think everybody's task is supposed to be the same. We think everybody's task is supposed to be that upright one because we come to church. Every now and then, God need to bring somebody in to move things forward in a way that we, as Christians, sometimes won't do. We'll say we love the Lord. We'll say we hear from the Lord. We'll say we'll do anything God tell us to do. Let him tell us to do that hard thing. Oh, I got to pray about it. What you praying about? You haven't been praying before now? If you got to stop and pray about it, I'm going to question your prayer life. You understand what I'm saying? Prayer, let me tell you something. This is not the sermon. I don't think it is. When the king asked Nehemiah, he said, Nehemiah, your face all tore up. And I'm paraphrasing. You tore up from the floor up. What in the world is going on with you? The Bible ain't say Nehemiah said, hold on, let me go pray. The Bible say Nehemiah prayed and answered the king. Good God from Zion. That means he was already hearing the voice of the Lord. He already knew what God had put on his heart for such a time as this.
That's right.
We got to get there, church. We don't have to pray about everything, and we don't have to be in everything. We just need to pick our lane, stay in our lane, and let God do what he going to do with us in our lane. Sometimes we'll get in somebody else's lane, then we'll talk about so-and-so, them don't do nothing at the church. Get out of their lane! Y'all know I'm not lying. Every now and then we got to back up. We ain't got to be the first jump, but I do it. I don't know where this stuff coming from. I'm just being honest with you. Sit down for a minute. Hear from God. See if God really wants you to jump up in the way. For real. Every now and then, God just wants us to sit down. Like prayer. We say we pray, but all we do is go, yip, 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 yip. And then we jump up, going about a bit. What prayer? Who are you praying to? Yourself? When you going to stop and hear from God? When you going to give yourself that downtime? You know, I shared yesterday, still this is not the message. I have no clue what's going on up here. Thank you, Holy Spirit. And God was just done something different with me. I never prepared this way. You know, he started giving me notes early in the week. And so, you know, you write all this stuff and you're going over it in your head and you're walking up and down the store. You preach to yourself, you preach to the wall, you preach to the Holy Ghost, you preach it to your wife, get on my face, boy. And so, you know, and I'm being honest with you, you know. And so yesterday, you know, I was opening the word up. He said, no, I need you. No. I need you to go lay down and go to sleep. That's what I need you to do. I need you to just get out of your own mindset and just go rest yourself for a minute. Because, see, I'm going to open it up, cracking it open, and I'm going to tell myself everything. See? So I go to sleep, and then it's about 5:30, 6 o'clock in the evening, go to sleep. Then I wake up about 10, 11, and I'm like, oh, I ain't going to sleep tonight. God say, good. Gotcha. See what I'm saying? Now you're going to hear me in my quiet time, not your quiet time. You're going to hear me in my quiet time. You're going to have the word that I give you. And that's exactly what he did. And so, you know, I end up to about, 3 this morning. On top of him getting me up at 2 o'clock Friday night. God, what are you doing here? He said, I'm preparing you. I prepare a table before you. in the presence of my enemy don't mean the table is for the enemy. It don't mean the table is about the enemy. The table is about you and for you. Too many times we want to bring the enemy in when they ain't got nothing to do with the enemy. Sometimes God just wants the enemy to see what he can do with us. Huh? Sorry, Brother Warren. But that's the way he gave it to me. And y'all understand later. So listen. I'm just trying to see if God wants me to get anything else before I get here. I just want to be obedient to this, amen, to this moment in time. When church, I'm here to tell you, there is something going on here in this church. And if you look around today and you can't see there's something going on here in this church, something is wrong. Today, in this moment of time, something is going on. There's a silent excitement in the air. Do you know what a silent excitement is? When they kind of well up on the inside of you and you ain't quite sure what to do with it and you don't want to shout, you know what I'm saying? You need to shout. You don't want to shout because you kind of want it to just simmer there and just well up and build up. It's almost like I shared with some people. I say, you know, it's like in the morning time, you know, and you get up early in the morning and you get your coffee ready I think I shared that in homework. Anyway, you get your coffee ready and you sit there and you sipping on your coffee and you reading the word of God and things start coming to you and you sipping on that coffee and you go, man, this coffee is good this morning. Now you steady sipping and you got your perker, your waker upper or whatever you call your coffee, and all of a sudden, bam, that revelation hits you. You jump up and go, whoo, that's greater than a cup of coffee. Y'all better get that. Y'all better get that. When that revelation hits you, that coffee ain't really wake you up. That revelation really woke you up. Better than a cup of coffee. What's better than a cup of coffee at 5 o'clock in the morning? Except for the revelation coming from the throne. Huh? Good God, I reckon. Look, we're gonna go to 2 Kings. I got so many pages folded in this thing. We're gonna go to 2 Kings. And we're going to go to chapter 5. Now that I think I done got out of the way, what I was hearing the Holy Spirit say, I think I was hearing the Holy Spirit. You know, people say, well, you should know if the Holy Spirit or not. Sometimes you have to say, God, make sure it ain't me. And if you ain't saying that, you better start saying that. 2 Kings, chapter 5, the word of God. Now, Naaman was commander of the army of the king of Aram. I'm reading out of NIV. Let me start over. Now, Naaman was commander of the army of the king of Aram. He was a great man in the sight of his master and highly regarded because through him the Lord has given victory to Aram. He was a valiant soldier, but he had leprosy. Now, bands from Aram had come out and had taken captive a young girl from Israel, and she served Naaman's wife. She said to her mistress, "If only my master would see the prophet who is in Samaria or Israel, he would cure him of his leprosy." Naaman went to his master, told him what the girl from Israel had said. "By all means, go," the king of Aram replied. "I'll send a letter to the king of Israel." So Naaman left, I know that's Jesus, taking with him 10 talents of silver, 6,000 shekels of gold, and 10 sets of clothing. The letter that he took to the king of Israel read, "With this letter I am sending my servant Naaman to you so that you may cure him of leprosy." And soon as the king of Israel read the letter, he tore his robe and said, "Am I God? Can I kill and bring back to life? Why do this fellow send someone to me to be cured of his leprosy? See how he's trying to pick a quarrel with me?" When Elijah, the man of God, heard that the king of Israel had torn his robe, he sent him this message. "Why have you torn your robe? Have the man come to me, and he will know that there is a prophet in Israel." So Naaman went with his horses and chariot and stopped at the door of Elijah's house. Elijah sent a messenger to say to him, "Go wash yourself 7 times in the Jordan, and your flesh will be restored, and you'll be clean." But Naaman went away angry and said, I thought he would surely come out to me and stand and call on the name of the Lord his God, wave his hand over the spot and cure me of my leprosy. Are not Abana and Pharah, the rivers of Damascus, better than any other water of Israel? Could not washing them and be clean? So he turned and went off in a rage. Naaman's servant went to him and said, my father, if the prophet had told you to do some great thing, would you not have done it? How much more then when he tells you, wash and be cleansed? So he went down and dipped himself in the Jordan 7 times as the man of God had told him, and his flesh was restored and became clean like that of a young boy. You may be seated. Thank you, God, for your word. Your word is always alive and quick and sharper than any two-edged sword. Your word is alive today and living today, Lord God. God, your word cut going in and coming out today, God. God, your word is so powerful and so awesome. It brings health to the neighbor and marrow to the bone. God, we bless you in your word today because it is your word that we speak back to you. Because you said it wouldn't even come back void, God. Have your way today. Perhaps we can talk about Naaman and his great feats as commander of the king's army. Perhaps we can talk about, you know, the riches he took to give to whoever healed him of his leprosy, you know. Or we can talk about how he wanted Elijah to come out and kind of, what's the word for it? Just put the explanation point around how great he is by doing this great thing over top of him. We could probably talk about all that great stuff that's in this particular passage of scripture. You know, we can talk about how the king of Israel humbled himself and tore his robe and repented in sackcloth and ashes and started scraping himself with barrels and stuff, broken barrels and bottles and pottery and stuff because he was in fear. We can talk about all these great things in this particular passage of scripture. And don't get me wrong, all these instances have in their own individual self, it's important. So don't hear me wrong. But today, we're going to talk about the little maid from Israel. Today, we're going to talk about what looked like the most least significant person in this passage of scripture. The little maid from Israel. Stay seated. I'm going to read 2-4 again, if y'all don't mind. I ain't going to keep you long. No longer the Spirit tell me to anyway. That means he done prepared you for the time that was set. Now, bands from Aram. I just had to hold up sometime. Had gone out and had taken captive a young girl from Israel. King James say a little maid from Israel. And she served Naaman's wife. And she said to her mistress, if only my master would see the prophet who is in Samaria or Israel, he will cure him of his leprosy. And Naaman went to his master and told him what the girl from Israel had said. And then the king bowed his head to her and said, yeah, go ahead. Let's take care of that. And let me give you all the stuff to take with you. So, you know, you can pay God off. You know how we want to pay God off every now and then. You know, God, if you do this, I'll do that. You know what I'm saying? We want to offer bribes. I'm the only one. We don't offer God bribes. Y'all know we do. So you know, and so the Bible say, you know, that was bands or companies that went out and on one of these raids, one of the companies or one of these bands had brought back a little maid from Israel. And so, you know, the same way, how often do these bands show up in our lives? You see, how often they come in and try to invade or raid our conscience of our spirit or try to lay things out in front of us that's contrary to what we thought God said, you know. Every now and then these bands will show up and they'll attack us in the very heart of our being. Every now and then these bands would show up and attack us in our marital relationship, or they would hit us in our financial stability or instability. Every now and then these bands will show up and they'll hit us in our health, or perhaps they'll hit us through or in our jobs. These bands will just show up and they want to invade our life. Every now and then, y'all know bands, these companies of invaders will just show up. Hey, we ain't got to invite them in. They'll just show up. They sitting at the door waiting for us to get home sometime. They sitting at the workplace waiting for us to get up on the job sometime. You know, Pastor Bond say the teachers have a daunting task. But I'm going to challenge the word daunting. They have a task. But it's only become daunting when these bands try to show up and ruffle what God called them to do in our education system. They got a teacher got to have joy, and they have to have pleasure in what they doing, to walk in them schools every day, and now knowing that they not safe whatsoever. I don't care how many bells and whistles you put in it, somebody gonna figure out a way to get around something if they got that invasion mindset. Well, these bands showed up in this girl's hometown. And I'm sure that she wasn't the only one that went into captivity. I'm sure she wasn't the only one that when they showed up, they took hostage and took back to their country, Syria. I'm talking about these bands that capture us and captivate us and hold us in bondage, when God's saying, they might come and they might even capture you, but don't let them captivate you. See, some things gonna happen in our life that we're just not gonna avoid. But we can't let them captivate us in a way that's gonna hold us there way too long, or longer than what God intended for us or them to be there. When they captivate our mindset and dampen our spirit and take hold of our very being, we can stay stuck in a place that longer than God want us to stay stuck there. See, they show up and take us captive. Hold us in a bondage that will captivate us, making us respond contrary. Thank you, Lord. Bless you, Holy Spirit. Contrary to the word of God. Oh, God is good. I'm like Pastor now. God is so good. You had to rub your stomach. I see why Pastor be rubbing his stomach all the time. It's like chicken on Sunday. Lord have mercy. Pastor called me yesterday, pray with me. And I was like, Pastor, didn't we talk about dinner? We were talking about Chinese food. Pastor said, bro, I don't eat Chinese food on Sunday. I eat chicken. Gotcha, Pastor. I like that. Pastor said, I eat chicken. Pastor, I'm with you, Pastor. I eat chicken too, Pastor. Amen. But God's God said a little girl from Israel didn't let her captivity turn into captivation because she was waiting on a revelation. I said, what? When we don't let our captivity captivate us, God can give us a revelation right in the circumstances that we are in. Right in the midst of trying to wrestle through this thing, God will reveal something to us that will release us from that thing. If we don't let the thing captivate us. God, you is good. Lord have mercy. So as a subject matter today, we're gonna talk a little bit about being captivated by our captivity. See, this little girl from Israel could have walked in her bitterness, her anger, her resentment, but she chose not to let her current situation dictate how she served. See, Naaman, commander of the army, you know, of Israel, he had leprosy. And what the little girl knew was that leprosy came with a price. So, you know, she's surrounded by all these great people, you know, Naaman, commander of the army, Ben-Hadad, king of Syria, Jehoram, king of Israel, Elijah the prophet, surrounded by all these great figures. You understand what I'm saying? And out of these great people, God used a little servant girl or a little maid from Israel, you know, in her own bondage to bless the man that she was a servant of. Y'all better get that. See, in the midst of great people, we often overlook the one that most of the time plays a crucial role in bringing glory to God. John the Baptist, he baptized Jesus. He the one that was the foreword for Jesus. Judas Iscariot, of course we know, a disciple, he betrayed Jesus, you know, straight to the cross. Betrayed him straight to the cross. Straight to the cross. Had no clue. God ordained it. You see what I'm saying? Aaron, not heard of a lot. He was the voice of Moses. Naomi, the mother-in-law of Ruth, she introduced him to Boaz, and he's a tight kinsman redeemer. You see? The unknown people that we will overlook, God is using to bring an answer to the end of your situation, if we could just humble ourselves and get rid of all that mess that's going on in us, you see what I'm saying? So he can speak to us through somebody, shuck off your own greatness. The Naaman, king of commander of the army, he wanted Elijah to come out and do this great miracle and wave up. Because see, he wanted Elijah to match who he thought he was. Every now and then, we want God to match who we think we are. God said, can't use you right now. I got to do you like I do Naaman, dear Naaman. I got to humble you. I got to stick you in some dirty water. And I ain't going to stick you in it one time. I got to take you down 7 times. Can you imagine right before he took that first dip? And he come up and, oh, that's why I gone. And then he kind of take that second dip. And he come up and, oh, that's why I gone too. Oh, let me get on up in here. Huh? When he start dipping and it start cleansing him. And it start washing. All his greatness in his mind just went away. Huh? All that stuff he thought he was just went away. Because see, let me tell you something. As a leper, let me tell you what Naaman was worried about. As a leper, he was going to lose his command. He was going to be separated from the people, excommunicated. He was going to become a nobody, living in caves and holes in the ground, ducking people, and nobody know who I am no more. He was worried about that. But see, he had a secret, and his secret was leprosy, and he had to figure it out. He had to do anything at any call. Here he is, a Syrian commander going to Israel to see a king who people and land he invaded, who people he took captivity, to go back to him and say, I need some help from you. Huh? Every now and then, God want to send us back to the people that we think. And say, can you give me a helping hand? Can you help me out over here? Daughter's good to see you, brother. A little maid from Israel. See, too often we get caught up in our own circumstance. And we forget God in charge. Too often we let the situation become bigger than our hope. Too often God have a hard time cracking through our head so he can get our heart to hear him. Too often we'll miss the miracle concentrating on the misery. Too often we miss the moment looking at what seemed to be a lifetime. The little girl didn't miss the moment. The little girl said, if only my master. You think the little girl didn't think about her mom and dad every now and then? And how this commander send this band in and split her whole household up? You think about this little girl every now and then, probably say, man, I got to clean this joker house again. I got to clean up these diapers behind his dirty little children. You know what I'm saying? I gotta wash her dishes, serve his wife. I got to do all these things. Want no bitterness, no resentment, no nothing. Who in bitterness going to say to their master, I know how you can get healed. I know how you can become whole. I know how you can become one with God. And the little girl, she didn't have no doubt. Here it is, Naaman, the commander of the Syrian army. She said to him, I know a prophet in Israel, and you can get healed. She wouldn't care nothing about that he was a commander. She didn't say, suppose God don't heal. It's going to be hell to pay when he get back here. She didn't say that. Huh? She didn't think about that. She had faith in her God. In bondage. In captivity. She didn't let her bondage captivate her mind to a place she started doubting God. As a matter of fact, she was in a place that she needed to build faith in God. So I'm going to send my master over here, and God going to heal him, because not only is he going to heal him, because I'm waiting for my release. I'm waiting for my day. Because if I can't believe God can heal him, how can I believe that God going to have my day to come forward? If I can't believe that God going to release you, how can I believe that God, that my day going to come forward? If I can't believe that God God is still God, don't make no difference where I'm at or what my circumstance is, how I'm going to get my healing, how I'm going to get my release, how I'm going to get my day in court. If I can't believe God for you, how am I believing God for me? I'm still talking about a little girl from Israel. We get captivated by the things that hold us captive. And that's not what God wants when things come along. Whew. See, what she didn't do, bless you, Lord, allow her captivity crazy, I reckon, to dictate her availability. Let me say that again. She didn't allow her captivity to dictate her availability. No matter what was going on, she was still saying, God, I'm still here. Use me. God, I'm still here. Use me, God. Just show me what I need to do, God. In my own bondage, God. In my own bad health, God. Show me how I can help somebody else. Huh? In my own confused mind, God. Show me how I can reach out to somebody else. In my own misgivings, God. Show me how I can bring a need to somebody else, God. God, in everything that's going on with me, I can't make myself bigger than you, God. God, in everything that's going on with me, I'm not going to allow my need to be bigger than the person's need that you call me to serve, God. God, in everything that's going on with me, God, I still need to look beyond myself, Lord God, and see the person that you sent me to, Lord God. In all the things that's going on with me, God, God, I really need to reach out, Lord God, further than myself. Because when we reach out further than ourselves, church. And that's what was going on with this little girl. She said, I see my circumstance, but I need to continue to believe in God. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to reach out to somebody else. As a matter of fact, the guy that's got me as a slave, I'm going to give him a helping hand. Because hold up. Name it. You want to know what his name is? Or the old Greek word for his name? Pleasantness. She being held in bondage by a man called Pleasantness. Man, that's like an oxymoron. Y'all know what an oxymoron is. So see, this little girl, you know, her heart didn't get callous because she was in bondage. Every now and then when things happen to us, our heart will get callous. You know, I know she wondered about her parents and family and all that stuff, you know, But let me tell you something. 1 Timothy 6:6 say godliness with contentment is great gain. See, contentment in the most adverse circumstance. Contentment when you don't understand what is happening. Contentment when you haven't heard from God. Contentment in such circumstances, listen to this, contentment in circumstances like this become an action word. What? Good God, I reckon. So it don't mean just being, okay, I'm all right with God. Contentment in this circumstances will put you to work. See, this is where contentment in great dismay become what? A faith move. Contentment in the midst of everything that's going on is a faith move. Because when you're content, you'll do something. Huh? When you're content, you'll keep moving. When you're content, you won't let it hold you back. Too often we let things just hold us back. Too often we let things become bigger than the emotions that God gave us to move forward in Him. Contentment in a great dismay is a faith move. That's a faith move. Everything going on around me, but I can say to you, Dick, I'm content. See, she sees the moment. She became a strong witness for the Lord in her bondage. See, by faith we understand that the world was formed by the word of God. Watch this. The maid from Israel had an opportunity to speak for God, and she was not so clouded by her circumstances that she could not hear from God. Tell the wife, I wish my Lord was the prophet that is in Samaria, for he would recover from his leprosy. Contentment took her boldly before Naaman's wife to tell her, hey, there's a prophet in Israel. That's a faith move. In bondage. There's a prophet in Israel. And she didn't say he might recover him. You know we pray, God, I know you can heal me. What about God? I know you will heal me. Every now and then, our misinterpretation of who God is will hold us bondage in a way that won't get us to where God wants us to get. Every now and then, our misinterpretation of the word of God will hold us in bondage, and it won't get us to the place he's trying to get us to. Every now and then, our misinterpretation of who we are in Christ will keep us stagnated in a way that we won't get the blessing of God, because what we say is, I'm going to give y'all testimony. Thank you, Lord. Let me tell y'all something. And my wife, she said it to me the other day. She said, honey, can I tell the story, honey? She said, honey, as long as I've been knowing you and as long as we've been married, you've always preached, can't no sickness come in my dwelling place. It can't live here. Not here. It can't open my front door. And then one day it showed up. And my wife said to me, honey, I was so set back. Because I know if you didn't believe in nothing, you believe we was not supposed to get sick. I had to sit down on it. And say, God, where did I misinterpret? Because my interpretation stagnated my family. And she said, honey, it changed my normalcy. I said, wow. She said, it took me to a place of a new norm. Most of y'all know my wife had cancer. And my wife had operations for. And she said, honey, I live a new normal now. And I'm so set back by this. My spirit been tore up. My heart been tore up. And look in the mirror and I see the scars of my new normal. And I'm just not sure about God right now. And that put me on my face. That did the same thing to me it did to the king of Israel. I had to get down in sackcloth and ashes and say, God, I never want to get in that position again. If you don't reveal it, I won't believe it. Now, I'm not saying that it was not true what I believed then. What I'm saying is I believed in it further than where God was going to take me to. Do you understand? Sometimes we'll stay somewhere longer than we're supposed to stay.
That's right.
Spiritually, mentally, and emotionally. Because he said, I also will heal you and cleanse you from all your diseases. See? So we can't heal and cleanse if, and that's where we was at. And I was like, whoa, and that's how this message came to me. Captivated in our captivity. And I said, God, at this point, I need to stay out the way. See, again, Naaman had a secret, and that secret was called leprosy. And when secrets get revealed, sometimes it ain't pretty. Sometimes it's a sore sight. Church, I'm here today to say to you, things gonna happen in life, but we cannot allow them to captivate us. We cannot allow them to hold us down. We cannot allow them to bring us to a place where we stop believing God. Because the Bible says in Hebrew, without faith it's impossible to please God. Because anyone who comes to him must believe that he exists and he a rewarder of them who diligently seek him. And so we have to understand that we have to continue to seek God in the most adverse situation, just like this little girl from Israel. See, here we have a maid or a slave from Israel telling her master, who is the head of all army, you better go back to where you invaded. Because that's where you're going to find your healing. That's where you're going to find your wholeness. Every now and then we had to go back to the place where the invasion came in at to find our healing, to find our wholeness, to find the place that God have us in so he can bring us out through and over the things that so easily beset us every now and then. Church, let me tell y'all something. This message is personal today. It took on a life of its own standing right here. See, every now and then, we have to take somebody else. Just like the little girl from Israel took Naaman to the throne of grace of God, we have to begin to take others before the throne of grace of God. See, we talk about we come boldly before the throne of grace, but every now and then, God wants you to take somebody else boldly before the throne of grace. That little girl took Naaman boldly before the throne of grace when she said, there's a prophet in Israel, and he'll heal you. And let me tell you today, there's a prophet in Virginia Beach and he will heal you. There's a prophet in the United States and he will heal you. There's a prophet that stands here today and his name, church, is Jesus. There's a prophet in here today and his name is Jesus, the Lord of Lords, the King of Kings, the Meshuach, the Messiah. There's a prophet in Turning Point Church and he will heal you today from all your sicknesses and all your diseases. And I had to believe this today, church, not just for my wife, not just for my church, but I had to believe this today for my own self. Amen. 4 weeks ago, I was diagnosed with cancer. And I'm saying, God, this ain't supposed to come in my dwelling place. And God say, okay, if it wasn't supposed to come and is there, what she going to do about it? You going to get captivated by? Huh? You going to get captivated by? Or you going to believe in the prophet that is in Israel? Today, church, let me tell y'all something. When it show up, you better know who you believe in. You better know who to call on. You better not let that thing become bigger than the God of Israel. You better not let that thing overcome you in a way that you're not praying. You're not sitting in. You're not getting up early. You're not going down late. As pastor preach three times a day. And three times a day, it might take five times a day to get your release, church. But I'm telling you, as long as Jesus, the prophet, is in this place, we're gonna go on our knees and we're gonna come up clean, just like Naaman did. And I believe that today, church. Ah, come up clean, just like Naaman did. Praise him. 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 Hallelujah. 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 Praise him. Praise him. Every now and then we have to make room for these kind of praises. We take a boldly before the throne of grace, God. David said, God, teach me to hide your word in my heart that I sin not against you. Word of God, he said, we're going to walk upright in your sight, God. He said, God, make the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart acceptable to you, God. Because this is where I'm at. I want to be like the one that came back and gave you the glory, Jesus. God, I ain't sure how it got clear. But other than you said it was going to happen. So, God, I think I'm going to turn around and come back myself. And I'm going to give you the glory. I'm going to praise you, God. God, I think I'm going to turn around and I'm going to come back, God. And God, I'm going to glorify you, Jesus. And Jesus, when I hear you say you've been made whole, Jesus, I'm going to give you some more glory, God. And God, I'm just going to sit at your feet, Jesus. See, what we don't understand is sometimes we got to come back and give him some glory. Every now and then. See, contentment is not acceptance to the situation, but acceptance through the situation. See, I'm not going to accept it because this is where I'm at. I'm going to accept it because this is where you need me to be right now, God. See, right now in this point in time, God, I'm not going to accept it because I'm going to live in it, God. I'm going to accept it because I'm going to walk out of it, God. That's why I'm going to accept it, God. Because I'm going to walk away from it, God. That's why I'm going to accept it. See, I'm going to be content in it, God, because I already know I'm going to walk out of this thing, God. God, I'm going to accept it because this is where you need me to be right now, God. Because you're going to show me how to walk out of it, God. Can you imagine with me for a moment the little maid from Israel when Naaman got back home, cleansed from his leprosy? Can you imagine how he came back and say, I now serve your God of Israel. Can you imagine when he told the little girl him, I got a sack of dirt for you from your hometown so you can give praise to the God of Israel that you sent me to. Not only did he cleanse me, but he saved my soul. Can you imagine for me for one moment, the little girl, when David said, you know what? All worldly gifts the prophet wouldn't take, I'm going to give them to you because you have faith in your God of Israel. Can you imagine the little girl? When he said, I'm going to restore everything that you lost in your captivity. Can you imagine that little girl when Naaman came back? Can you imagine how she lived from that point on? See, the Bible don't get into this whole story right here. But he left it to the imagination. Can you imagine how it is when God give you a breakthrough? When he give you a breakthrough in your health. When he give you a breakthrough in your finances. When he give you a breakthrough in your mindset. When he give you a mental and emotional breakthrough. When you have that spiritual breakthrough in your body. Can you imagine for a moment how this little girl feel when she woke up one day and realized she was serving under somebody that loved the Lord God of Israel that she sent him to. Oh, can you imagine that with me for a moment, church? Because see, I got to imagine that for myself today, church. I got to imagine that in my own heart today, church. I got to imagine that in my own mind today, church. I got to imagine that in my own spirit today, church. I got to imagine that on the other end, there's riches that I don't even understand, and I ain't talking about the pocketbook. I want you to hear me today, church. We still talk about a little maid from Israel, church. Look, girl, I'm going out and I'm going to hunt for your family. I'm going to restore your family back to you. I'm going to bring them in and I'm going to set you up. As a matter of fact, I don't want you to serve me no more. I'm going to get somebody to serve you. Because you introduced me to the prophet that was in Israel. See, church, God said to me, Eddie, the healing of the leprosy wasn't a hard miracle for me. Eddie, healing you is not a hard miracle for me. He said the hard miracle was when I had to get the commander of the army to humble himself. He said the real miracle was when I had to get the commander of the army to look to me and say, I now believe in you, Lord God of Israel. He said, I can do all kind of miracles. He said, I can heal sicknesses. I can heal diseases. I can do financial healing. I can do all these other things. But as awesome of a God that I am, people say there's something God can't do, but there is one thing God can't do. God can't make us serve him. Because if he did, he would become a dictator just like the devil. He wants us to come boldly before the throne of grace to find grace and mercy in times of need. I'm preaching to myself here, church. I can imagine the little girl heard God when he said to her in the book of Jeremiah, go ahead on with them, build houses and settle down, plant garden and eat what they produce. In other words, he's saying, don't concentrate on your captivity. Live life every day. Let things come out of you. Be prosperous in your heart, soul, mind, and spirit every day. And when you do that, I'm going to take away the captivation and give you a revelation. So that way, you'll be able to get the things I really have. See, he had to... God just said to me, I had to take her to captivity so she could get an understanding of what freedom is. See, sometimes we miss God when he says, settle down, build your tabernacles of faith. Eat the fruit of the word and come back to me because I'm married to the backslider. Don't lose heart. Fight the good fight of faith because I'll never leave you nor shall I forsake you. See, the little maid from Israel did not try to toot her own horn. She loved her master. She wanted him healed. She didn't say, let me go with you. I'll show you where to find him at because I know exactly where he is. See, she wanted to get out in front of this thing. She didn't do that. She did her part, then she got out of the way. Sometimes when I said earlier we need to do our part, get out of the way. And that's what she did. She did her part, got out of her way, and I can imagine when Naaman came back. See, she wasn't trying to be relevant. As my wife say, too many people want to be relevant when you tell them you're sick. So I don't tell them because they want to become doctors and prophets. See, this little girl won't try to be irrelevant. She was just being obedient. And all God wants from us, all God wants from us, that one word keys it all in, obedience. If we're obedient, he can do anything with us he wants to do. Bible says, stand and see the salvation of the Lord. Church, we're the salt of the earth. Beacons on the hill. Lighting the way for the leper. I say to your praises, you're the beacon on the hill. You're the salt of the earth. And God is going to use your salt to preserve a Naaman and cleanse him from his leprosy. I say to your praises, honey, I say to your cry, God gonna use your tears. Revelation said he collect them in the bottle to pour them back upon you. I say to you in your tears, you're light on the hill. You're the salt of the earth. And God gonna use you to preserve somebody. I say that to you. Church, I say to you today, you're the salt of the earth. You're a beacon on here. Down in all of your struggles, you're still the salt of the earth. You're still a beacon on the hill. You light the way for somebody. You're preserving somebody through your testimony. You may be in captivity. I may be in captivity, but guess what? There's a Naaman waiting for us to come along so we can send him to the prophet that is in Israel, to the prophet that is in this church today, to the prophet Jesus the Christ, the anointed one, the holy one of Israel, the healer, the redeemer, my Mashiach and my Messiah, Jesus the Christ. Church, I'm here to tell you today, there's a prophet in Israel. David said this in closing, I'm still confident of this one thing. I will see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Wait on the Lord, I say, church. Wait on the Lord, I say, church. Be strong. Take heart. Wait on the Lord. Amen. Amen. Give God a hand, church. Give God a hand, church. Give God a hand, church. Give him a hand clap of praise, church. Give him a hand clap of praise, church. Hallelujah. Give him a hand clap of praise. Give him a hand clap of praise, church. Hallelujah. There's a prophet in Israel, church, and he's here for the healing of the church. There's a prophet in Turning Point today, church, and he hear your heart, and he hear your cry. There's a prophet in this place today, church, and he want to heal us from all our sicknesses and all our diseases. It might have came near our dwelling place, but God is still all up in our dwelling place, and he still can push it on out the front door. That's a prophet in Israel. I'm not going to assume everybody's saved. I'm not going to assume that. I ain't even going to assume everybody stays saved. Because, man, when stuff happens, sometimes I have to question my own salvation. Like, God, didn't your word say, am I still saved? Is this? Hey, listen, I'm revealing my own humanity. Did something happen that I get lost somewhere? You know what I'm saying? Did I make a wrong turn, God? You know, maybe I'm the only one to ask that question. You know, God, I thought, God, that if you don't know Jesus, listen, chuck that stuff off. His spot right here. Bowl at the throne of grace. I'm talking about open confession right now. I'm talking about saying, you know what, Even to the backslide. I got to get back. I got to get back. You know in your heart if you kind of shrug God off and you kind of, you know, give him a drive-by here and there. You know that. You know in your heart if that's what you're doing. And that's okay. Because he said he married to us. Because, see, he ain't gave me the full definition of backslide. Backslide don't mean I had to go out and commit some great sin. It could mean I doubted God in a situation. You see, we've been taught backslide means, oh, you went out there and lived the luxuries of the world and you gave God up. I ain't heard him say that. We could have doubted God. We could have lost faith. That's backsliding. You know. When your car slide, whether they're going to ditch or not, it still slid.
Right,
right? That's right. Lost your grip. We can get our grip back right here. Hey, you ain't even got to say to me what the grip was. Just come on up and let us pray for you. Let me get a couple of leaders, deacons, laymen, cameramen, somebody up here. Is there one here today? For whatever the reason may be. Sin, doubt, disbelief. The Bible said it ain't no faith in sin. Is that what the word say?
That's what the word says.
That's kind of like backsliding, eh? If it ain't no faith, oh, well, I better stay in here too, then. I'm going to be honest with you. Because when you keep getting hit, it jar your faith. Amen? And when you keep getting hit, it make you step back. Any. Hey, I stepped back, I slid, I lost my grip, whatever. Come on. Look, Naaman had a whole lot of pride.
Oh, yes.
His pride took him to muddy water. Listen, let's not have a muddy water experience.
Come on,
let's come on and do this now. Yeah. Is there any that say, you know what, I had almost gave up on, hallelujah. I had almost gave up on God. But I came to church today. There's another one. All you got to do is come on. All you got to do is come on. I was right at the point. I was going to turn my back and say, you know what? I ain't going to church no more. I ain't reading no more. I ain't going to Bible study no more. I ain't going to home group no more. I ain't doing none of that stuff no more. I ain't even going to talk about God no more. Come on. It's a spot here. Because that hurt and that pain is something else. I'm here to tell y'all. Don't wait on the muddy water. Because we got the water of life flowing from the throne. Is there another one? Just come on. You stand here with me. I guess I had to preach today so God could have me up front as a testimony. A little doubt, a little disbelief sometimes when these things start hitting you, them bands start coming in and smacking you. God been serving you all these years and you keep hitting me with the overhand rights. And I'm about ready to just lay down on you. I'm going to take a fall here in a minute, God. This is another one. I mean, we might well be honest with ourselves. Today is the day of salvation. Look. Part of accepting the Lord is being able to say, God, here's my truth. And you don't got to tell it. Just coming forward saying, you know what, I have a truth that I need to release. Is there another one? You know, God said to me, he said, tell Pastor Bone, get all the preliminaries out the way. I said, I'm going to tell him how to run the church. He said, I'm telling you to tell him how to run the church. Because at the end of this, there's something I'm going to need you to say. None of this was part of my sermon. Let me just help y'all with this. You got some issues going on, and you were saying, I'm on my last leg with God. I do physical therapy, and one of my therapies is I got to stand on this leg right here 10 seconds, 10 sessions. So some of you standing on one leg. And as you're going to make it to all 10 seconds, all 10 sessions, is there another before we pray? Before we ask God to move in the heart of his people? Let's close this up a little bit. 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 No. Let them face people, because people gonna know. People gonna pray. People gonna pray. Hey, man of God won't pray for him too. I'll be honest with you. People gonna pray. And this is what I want y'all to do. As the Spirit leads you, no matter how short you think it is, I want you to pray for these folks that are standing here. And I'm gonna give y'all about 3-4 minutes. Just open prayer for them. Don't call no names. Don't try to know their circumstances. Don't try to be the prophet. And then when God tell me, I'm going to close it. Hallelujah. 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 Pray openly if you have a prayer for them. Hallelujah. 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 Hallelujah.
Father, you see the boldness in the humility of the
cause. Hallelujah. Yes. Yes. Hallelujah. 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 Hallelujah, God. Hallelujah. 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 Hallelujah.
For there is no healer with you. There is no God with you, and there is no power with your power.
Hallelujah.
We bless you for this land. We thank you for it. In the name of the Lord Jesus.
In the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 Hallelujah.
Your word says he that humbleth himself shall be exalted.
Hallelujah.
Lord, and even in the stepping forward, your people stepping forward.
Hallelujah.
Lord, there is the breaking up of fallow ground.
Hallelujah.
There is, oh God, your spirit raising your people up.
Hallelujah.
Even to the place, Lord God, that you have desired, oh God, that your people should be.
Hallelujah.
So we give you thanks for today, for your word,
Hallelujah.
For your spirit,
Hallelujah.
And for life.
Hallelujah.
We just bless you today, God,
you
for
today,
your faithfulness.
God. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Father, we thank you that you've helped us to see that we're in this together, oh God.
Yes, God. Hallelujah.
Lord, I think about those rooms in my life, oh God, that are where the secret is, oh God, where the frustration is, oh God, where there are things that just seem to be unresolved, Lord God.
Jesus.
Lord, we thank you, Lord God, for how you have just brought light into those rooms, Lord God, and help us, oh God, to recognize. Sometimes we thought that room shouldn't even be there, God.
Hallelujah.
Why is it there? But you're calling us out, oh God, through our obedience to you, oh God.
Hallelujah.
So, Lord God, it's not praying just for these people. Lord,
Jesus.
It's praying ourselves, oh
Jesus.
God. Everybody's got
Jesus.
Those kind of rooms, oh God.
Jesus.
Everybody's got those places of
Jesus.
Doubt, oh God. There are places that we've
Jesus.
All slid, oh God.
Jesus.
And it wasn't back in the day, oh God.
Hallelujah.
We've been sliding today
Hallelujah.
And yesterday, oh
Jesus.
God. We everything else we can praise you, but there have been
Jesus.
Things, oh God,
Hallelujah.
That have just nagged at us, oh God.
Hallelujah.
And they even seem to want to speak to us and talk back to us and
Hallelujah.
Say things to us because we've been dealing with them for a long time. But Lord, we thank
time.
You, Lord God, for how you know how to get that word
Jesus.
To us, oh God, and help us, oh God, to understand. And Lord, we are not alone, God. So we stand together as a group, oh God. We stand together and believe you, oh God. Lord God, just like they needed to hold their hands up, oh God. Lord, we hold one another's hands up, oh God. You've designed this, oh God. Yeah, we got to believe you for ourselves, oh God. But you haven't. Just like you don't leave us alone. We're going to be followers after you. We won't leave each other alone, oh God. We'll hold each other's hands up, oh God. So that, Lord God, we're not captivated by these things, oh God. We'll continue to move on, oh God, and do what you called us to do, oh God. Thank you that you've set us free, oh God.
Yes, God.
Holly, every household, Lord, you've come into the household. We may even go into our physical houses, oh God, and find, oh God, how you've released us, oh God. Because it was a thing of our hearts, oh God.
Hallelujah, Jesus.
I bless you today, we bless oh God, you for today, what you're God. Doing. Lord, there are people praying now that have circumstances triple, it seems, times us, Lord. But you're ministering to them as they minister to me, oh God. As they minister to others, oh God. That's the way you've set it up, oh God.
Hallelujah.
So we bless your name
we
today,
bless
oh
your
God.
Name today,
you
God.
Got a way that's beyond any other kind of way, oh God.
Jesus.
It gets results, oh God. So we thank you for it, oh
we
God.
Thank you for
we
it.
Thank you for
we
it.
Thank you for it. We thank you for it.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Lord God.
We thank you.
Hallelujah, Lord God.
We thank you for it.
Lord God, we thank you. We thank you for openness, Lord. We
thank you
for the boldness, Lord, that you have imparted on our brother in bringing this word today. Lord, we
thank
you for opening up every cupboard in our hearts, oh God. Lord, those that's been closed way too long. Lord, to move those cobwebs out of there now, oh God. Lord God, to be able to give us, Lord, the boldness to be able to speak, Lord God, life back into these dismal areas, oh God.
Thank you, God.
Lord, as we hear this word, Lord, and we understand that pride could just keep us, Lord God, from being able to move forward in you, Lord God. I thank you, Lord, that you have given us a spirit of boldness, because you're not giving us a spirit of fear, oh God, but of love and of a sound mind, oh
God.
So, Lord, as you are speaking to our minds right now and our hearts, Lord
God,
Lord, I just ask that you continue to search us out, oh God. Lord, search us out like we have never been searched before. Lord, you ordained this day for such a time as this, Lord
God.
This is no ordinary service, oh God. Lord, this time of reconciliation in our hearts, Lord, is just designed to break the captivity of stronghold bonds that have been holding us back way too long, oh God. So, Lord, we thank you for your openness. Lord, we thank you for the boldness, and we thank you for operating Holy Spirit. Lord, we have a mantra in our track that says, subject to the leading of the Holy Spirit. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for immersing us now. Thank you, Lord God, for the man of God that is listening to you, Holy Spirit, in all that you're doing in the hearts of each and every one of us. Even me, oh God. Lord, I ask that you continue to search me from the inside out, oh God. To do the things that you have called me to do and to get out of my own way, Lord God, so you could do what you do best, oh God. Hallelujah.
Father, we thank you today.
Hallelujah.
We bless your holy name, God.
Yes, God.
God, we thank you that you have brought us to a place of humility in and of our own self, God. God, we thank you that you have brought us to this place of cleansing, Lord God. God, we thank you. You have brought us to this place of revelation, God. Oh, God, that we need you to work these things out in our lives, God.
Yes.
God, where there is emotional, mental, spiritual, or physical setbacks, Lord God. God, we thank you. You have brought us here, Lord God, to humble ourselves before you, God, to confess our faults one to another, Lord God. And God, we thank you for the healing, Lord God. Jesus, you died for our healing. The stripes of our peace is upon you, Lord Jesus. We bless you today. And as we walk, God, teach us how to walk in the wholeness of the place you brought us to at this moment in time. And we pray this in Jesus' name.
Jesus' name.
Amen. 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 God may be seated. Amen. God may be seated. Amen. Amen. Praise God. Praise God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Before I close, I'm going to open up the church. Have God spoken to anybody's heart to join this branch of Zion? You've been coming. It may be your first time here. Our doors is open. This is a place of healing. It's a place of restitution. This is a place where Jesus lives. Not only in this building, but in the hearts of the people that come through that door. If there's one that want to make this a church home, you can raise your hand, you can come forward. We're going to give you the right hand of fellowship. We're going to welcome you in. Not the body, because you're already in the body, but in the building, where the body come together. You're not confused about that. He said, one, this is Turning Point Church. And we is a happy people. We may have issues, but we is a happy people.
Yeah, let's give God a hand. Let's give God a hand. Let's give God a hand.